Well, it is good to welcome you here this morning, and our children are being dismissed to Children's Church, and so we're just thankful to have all of them here. And if you're new this morning, you feel free to go with them if you like to kind of transition them over and see kind of what they're doing, and you can welcome to come back if you'd like to. So that's awesome. It is great to welcome you here. We're in the second Sunday of a series called Believe. And the topic for this morning is personal God. I believe God is involved in and cares about my daily life. And that's an important topic. It really is. And so we'll be talking a little bit about that today. And we're going to talk about some of the things that, some of the questions that I think are sparked with a topic like this. In fact, in the YouVersion app, if you pull that up, you'll kind of see how we want to arrange the message time this morning. There's basically four parts to this, and so we want to answer some key questions that are related to this theme of personal God. It's important that we do that, and so we'll kind of start out with that this morning. And then we're going to look at Psalm 139, and we'll just kind of see what the Lord has for us in that psalm. It's a very highly personal psalm, and it definitely verifies and complements and amplifies our theme for this morning of a personal God. And then we're going to have an important exhortation related to a personal God from Chad Wilson today. He's here and be sharing with us, and many of you know him. And so he'll be sharing an exhortation with us today, and then also at the end of the message, we would like to invite you to begin a personal relationship with Christ if you haven't already done that. And so this is kind of how things are flowing this morning. And then something else to get you to think about as well is some key concepts from Psalm 139. Psalm 139 is written in the language of pursuit and capture. And I tell you this up front because when we begin to work our way through it, I think you'll kind of see it, but if you know it kind of in advance, it'll help you kind of think a little bit more about that. And so it's written in the language of pursuit and capture. David was a great poet, and he, like the video says, a great leader in Israel, and he was very open, and he learned to be transparent with God, but it wasn't always that way. You see, there's something in us that wants to hide from God. There's something in us that we don't like transparency. We avoid that because we feel, I think, if we are fully known, we're not going to be loved. And so we run from intimacy and being known. But yet, at the same time, there's something within our humanity that wants to be known. We long for it. We long for someone to give us an empathetic ear. Someone that we can share our story with. Someone that can know us. And someone that we can get to know. And we long for it. And yet we fear it at the same time. And so in light of these things, I would just share with you this morning that Psalm 139 is written in the language of pursuit and capture. And the question I have for you is, are you running from God? And if so, where are you going? If you're running from God, where are you headed? Number two, second concept is Psalm 139 is written in the language of hide and seek. You remember playing hide and seek as a kid? Big game for the Nelsons, all right? All summer long we play hide and seek. We love that. Well, question is, are you hiding from God? And in what ways? Third concept here is Psalm 139 is written in the language of a diary journal. Are you feeling hemmed in by God or by life, and how so? So those are some kind of application questions for you to think about as we, in just a few moments, get into Psalm 139. I just will remind you this morning, in light of the giving team and things, I kind of share with you sometimes about what's going on in my own personal life. And so I continue to track with Will there in Fairbanks, Alaska, and the Iditarod. Some of that stuff is happening. Kind of an exciting time, like second or third year it's ever started in Fairbanks, so he kind of got to witness that. But I got a text from him the other day. It said, you know, I'm going to order checks. Okay. You know, he's adulting, right? He's trying to figure out, he's trying to figure out how in the world do I do life as an adult. So he says, I'm going to order checks. It's like, that's out of the blue. You know, I did a lot of other things going, I'm going to order checks. All right, well, why do you need checks? You know, we got debit cards, and that's the way the millennial generation does it, right? You just have a debit card, and you get online, you transfer your money over to where it needs to be, and you don't need checks, or at least a lot of them don't even have checks. Said, I want to order me some checks. It's like, okay, buddy, you order you some checks. By the way, why do you want to order checks? He said, you know, I want to give a tithe to my church. Yes! Old loincloth Will is going to give a tithe to his church. I'm like, holy cow, Stone Seal had an impact I didn't know about. But isn't that great? And so we'll have to follow through and see if he's writing those checks. And maybe we churches need to get up with the times and start swiping cards instead of just checks, all right? But maybe not. But God is good, and I really appreciate that. And then we have, it's good to come to church and just feel the goodness of the community. And sometimes there's funny things that happen out in the congregation that I don't even know about and I hear about later. Last week, there's a great family. I just love them to death. And they were here, and one of their daughters was home from college break, and her brother asked for some chapstick. She reached over and gave him some lipstick. He put lipstick on his lips and had red lips before he left church today. So, by the way, if somebody looks at you a little funny, you might want to go check your lips, because it's good, isn't it? God is good. And if I'd only known that, maybe I could have had him stand and pray for us. And so that, you guys could have given praise that way. But he is good, and we're making it. God is just faithful to help us through our week, through what we're facing in life. And most importantly, he is a personal God. And that's kind of where we're going here today. And so that what it does, it prompts many, many questions when we have a topic like this. Is God a personal God? And that's a question we got. And is God a person that can be known and that can know me? You see, last week we looked at the triunity of God. We looked at God the Father above us, who's sovereign over all. We have God the Son beside us, who has walked life's earth with us. And we have God the Holy Spirit living within us. And so he's God above, beside, and within. And that's a distinctively Christian doctrine, and we're called to believe it. And even though we can't go to any specific place in the Bible and begin to and share with you where God says, okay, now I'm going to talk to you about the Trinity. And here's book, chapter, and verse that we just lay out the concept of the Trinity. You'll never find it. It's not, in fact, the word Trinity is not even in the Bible. But it's in the, always in the background of everything that we read, in the foreground of Scripture. The Bible assumes it with the let us make, back in Genesis 1, all the way down to Jesus' baptism, all the way through. We have this Trinitarian concept of God going on. It's distinctively Christian. You won't find it in any other world religion. Why? Because nobody will accede to the fact that Jesus is fully man, he's fully God. And that's a Christian doctrine. Okay? And so that's who we are. That's part of who we are. Now, if God is above us, he's beside us, he's within us, what does that mean? That means he can hear every prayer in the world simultaneously. He has no restrictions like we have. He knows your dreams. He knows your thoughts. He knows your plans. He knows everything there is to know about you, within and without. He knows all things pertaining to your life. He knows it. And see, a Trinitarian God has no restrictions like we have. And so, when we talk about, in light of the Trinitarian view of God and the truth of God as Trinity, it's the next logical step that we need to take in that whole idea is that God can know me personally, and he can know all of us simultaneously personally. And so, the question is, if God can know me simultaneously and all of us simultaneously, hear all the prayers, he sees everything that's going on in the world, nothing escapes his gaze or notice. The question is, that I have, and that maybe you have, is how can I know God? How can I know him? Another way we can ask this is, what is Christianity? Is Christianity a philosophy? Is it a worldview? Well, certainly it's a worldview. We espouse truth statements, belief statements, propositional statements. We have certain things we believe and we hold to, and that's true. Christianity is definitely a worldview, but is it the sum total of what Christianity is? Is Christianity an ethical stance? Well, certainly it has morals that it presents. It has ethics that it espouses and that would recommend that people live their life by. It certainly is an ethical stance kind of belief, but is it the sum total of Christianity? So it is philosophy, it is an ethical stance. Christianity certainly ranks among the world religions, so we know it is a religion if we want to speak in those terms. Christianity is certainly a religion, it would qualify as a religion, and so on. But what is it essentially? How could we summarize and sum up Christianity? Christianity is a relationship. More than just an ethical stance, more than just a philosophical worldview point, more than just a religion that we can find and search among the world of religions in the world, it is primarily a relationship. And a person who becomes a Christian moves from knowing about God, about morals, about philosophy and worldview points, about religion. A person who is a Christian is one who moves from knowing about God to knowing God directly and intimately. That is Christianity, to know God personally. And the question that prompts is, why do I need to know God? Well, there are several things we could say to that. But this morning, I'll just keep it practical, and that is that you'll never get life right until you know God. It'll never happen. You see, our desire to personally know God is so strong, but we fail to recognize that this desire to know God, we fail to recognize it for what it is. We fail to recognize that this desire to know God, we fail to recognize it for what it is. We fall in love. We break into a chosen field. We get married. We maybe reach a certain amount of money that we've always been hoping to acquire. We maybe acquire another home, and we anticipate all kinds of things that we think will come to us once we have these things. We eventually learn, though, that the precious something we seek cannot be found in lover, it cannot be found in career, it cannot be found in achievement, and there's nothing wrong with lover, career, and achievement. These are good things. These are good things that God's provisions in our life. But when we realize that there is a longing still that goes unquenched or unsatisfied, we begin to question, what is the purpose of life, and why do I feel homesick at home? Why should this be different? It's not how I had it pictured. And there are several ways to respond to this longing. There are several ways to respond to this unfulfilled desire that we as human beings have experienced or may be experiencing even today. We can blame the things themselves. We can find fault with everybody in our life. We can find fault with everything around us. We can blame our spouse. We can blame our boss. We can blame our parents. We can change mates and partners, and we can change jobs and settings. We can blame ourselves. We made some bad decisions. We can blame our circumstances. It's the way we were raised. But a Christian is one who recognizes that this life emptiness comes from our separation from God, that we are not in a right relationship with my Maker and our Maker, with this triune God. We're not walking with Him. We're not surrendered to His sovereignty. We're ignoring the fact that He's beside us in Jesus. And we certainly are resistant to anything that might invade my life personally and come inside me and begin to tell me things about myself and about life and about how I should live it. We resist the triune fellowship of God. And we're not in that Trinitarian dance and triunity dance that we talked about last week. But Christians are those who recognize this for what it is. That at the very core of who we are, there's this longing. And it's only in a right relationship with God that this longing can be met. And establishing a personal relationship with Him is the best hope that any of us ever have of getting life right. It's the best hope of the world. And I have to tell you this morning, though flawed and sinful, it brings me great comfort to know that I'm loved and I'm accepted in Christ. I have to tell you this morning that though weak and limited, I am strengthened and enabled in Him to do maybe what I never thought I could do. Though scarred by things in life and though broken in many ways, I have to tell you this morning that I am made whole and complete in Him, and He's got me on a journey of healing. And I have to tell you this morning that though lonely and distracted by many things in life, I am attended to and I am refocused on the life's true purpose in Him, in this triune God who has done so much to create me and done so much to redeem me and done so much to apply the whole plan of salvation to me. I have to tell you this morning that though my life may be offensive to some and though my life may be a disappointment to others, I am forgiven and I'm challenged. I'm challenged to make Christ number one, to make this Trinitarian God number one in my life. And I tell you this morning, I make no qualms about it. I owe my very life to this Trinitarian triune God who has showed up in my world in Jesus. I was talking to somebody this over lunch this week, and after we got through, he sent me a text and said, I felt like I was just talking to my old friend I hadn't caught up with since high school for a long, long time. And I thought about that, and I think that probably that's how I best would describe Jesus. Like an old friend who's kind of been with me and tracking with me all through my life history. He was there when I first encountered Him in second grade in a personal way. He was there as when I kind of reconsecrated things to Him in 13 or 14 years of age and getting on the wrong track in a hurry. He was there when I worked through the tumultuous teenage years, making decisions, trying smoking and chewing and all the things that cussing, all the things that you want to do, and you just spread your wings and start trying to fly on your own. He was there and He walked with me through all of that. I remember when I got married, He was with me when I got married, and it was a wonderful day, but I remember crying in my wedding, not because it wasn't good, it was really good, but I remember when the pastor had us kneeling, I just felt the presence of the Lord at my wedding, and so He was there when Megan was born, and Will and Levi were born, and just the emotion of that. Jesus and I, we spend time together. We laugh together, we cry together, we fight it out together. It's just like an old friend. It's just like an old friend. He's been with me through all of it. And with me through the empty nest things that's been going on and all the things related to that. We laugh together, we cry together, we fight together. We spend time together. We are buddies. And that's really about the best way I can really say it this morning. If you don't understand that, I'm not sure how to tell you any other way. It's just a friendship in life. If there's critical moments, if like I said, empty nest moments, whatever I'm going through, wherever I'm at, it's just good to know that the Trinitarian God is working in my behalf. God's sovereignly watching over. Jesus is beside me. Spirit's within me. And we're going to figure this thing out together. And I tell you, if you don't get anything else this morning, just get that. You need Christ. You need God in your life as an old friend who will walk with you and know you and love you. You know, when I was thinking about Psalm 139 this week, and we'll just pull that up on the screen, there's some really incredible things that we can point out about in this psalm. And perhaps what I'll do is just kind of read through it quickly here in your hearing here this morning, and then I want you to see a couple things. And what I want you to keep in mind is, I just want you to keep in mind how David, getting back to how I originally started this thing, sometimes being known by a Trinitarian God can be an intimidating thing, especially if there's things in your life you don't want Him to know about. And you think about, one author talked this week about the peephole effect, right? What's the peephole effect? Well, new doors these days, you don't really know what a peephole is, or, you know, peeping through the keyhole. We had old doors, older doors in our house, okay, and sometimes I'd peep through the keyhole. Anybody else ever peep through the keyhole to see what was going on the other side of the room? Okay, some of you honest, all right. Yeah, I peeped through the keyhole. And you peep through the keyhole, and sometimes we feel violated if we know that somebody's been peeping through the keyhole at us. Now, you have a family of mom and a dad and five kids. I guarantee you one of those kids is going to end up peeping through the keyhole with the other one. And it's going to create some problems in the family somewhere along the way. Winter can get boring in a family of five, right? So you're going to figure something out to do for entertainment. So you're going to peep through the keyhole. And then somebody's going to find out that you've been peeping through the keyhole. And they're going to get mad. And they're going to feel violated and upset. Well, sometimes that's the way we feel. And that's the way the psalmist felt in a particular point in his life. There's this knowledge. This person was looking into his life. And there were things in his life. He didn't like the fact he couldn't control it. And sometimes we don't like the fact that we can't control what God knows or anybody else knows. And that aggravates us and that grates on us, right? And it's like almost like God can see us at all times. And it's like I said last week, we're being triple teamed. Father, Son, and Spirit. How can we get away from this guy? He is everywhere, in everything, all around me, before me, behind me, underneath me, beside me. He is everywhere, multidimensional. There's no escaping this guy. And the psalmist went through a time, a spiritual crisis in his life, where he didn't like that. And maybe that's where some of you are. But I want you to see something in this psalm. And what this psalm shows us is that he works. There's a tone change in the psalm. And he works from that place of, I'm afraid for this God to see me for who I really am because I'm not sure about Him. And last week we addressed some of those concepts of God and how that really He is a God that we can trust. And as the psalmist moves from a place where he didn't like the fact that God had access to all this information about him and he's trying to escape it, he comes to this beautiful place in the psalm. By the time we get to the end, where he says, you know what? He knows everything, but he's not just a peephole God looking to get information on me, looking to find me and see me in my weaknesses so he can exploit me later. No, he's a God. And what if this great Trinitarian God is willing to use all of that knowledge, all of that power, all of that omniscience, omnipotence, omnipresence. And what if he's willing to use all of that for good in my life? Would I avoid him? Would I view him as a peephole kind of God, violating me, knowing things about me I don't want him or anybody else to know? Or could I enlist him as a friend? Could I enlist him as a fellow partner? Living life with him, loving him, walking with him. And that's what happens in Psalm 139. Okay? I'll show it to you a little more clearly. I plan on saying a little more about these words and phrases as I was going through, but I'm just going to quickly go through. We're going to read all 24 verses, and then I'll just point out a couple things to you, and then we're going to transition and have some opportunity here for you to kind of get to personally apply some of the things we're talking about. Psalmist, and I want you to think of this as a prayer journal, okay? And it goes public. It gets canonized. And it's in our Bibles, all right? But I kind of think that David probably wrote this, a great poet, warrior poet. I kind of think he probably wrote it maybe leaning up against a rock on a hillside somewhere, late on a Palestinian Israeli evening while the sun was setting, maybe over the Mediterranean. All right, I kind of think he probably had this wonderful moment where he was able to kind of put these thoughts together, and it's awesome. And maybe he didn't intend for it to be read by everybody, but sure enough, we are, and God is using it today in a special way, and we're appreciative of that. But you're going to see some things at the end of the psalm. He's like, wow, how could David say that? Well, personal journal, you write a lot of things you don't want other people to see, right? Personal journal, you have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. So when I get up in the morning, I go do my day, and I come home at night, you have been with me all every step of the way, every moment. You know all my thoughts in all of those moments where I've gone and what I've done and who I've been with. You are familiar with all my ways. Verse 4. But before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before. You see, David's kind of feeling smothered by this people, God. He's feeling smothered. He's feeling hemmed in. I don't know that I like being hemmed in like this. Maybe God's hemming you in. Well, he's hemming David in, and David wasn't so sure that he liked it. But you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your Trinitarian presence? There is no escape. There is no reason to even try. But yet I don't want God knowing everything about my life. So he's in this dilemma. Next slide. Verse 8. If I go up to the heavens, notice the polarity, the opposites to show you everything in between. If I go up to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn looking east, you are there. If I settle on the far side of the sea over the Mediterranean at the west, utter west, you're there. And even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. God doesn't have a right hand. It's anthropomorphism. He's picturing God as having a right hand. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. You have night vision goggles. You can see even in the dark. It doesn't, even if I'm feeling smothered and I'm suffocating in the presence of God because there are things in my life I don't want Him to know about, I get in the dark. He still sees me there. It's light. It's light to you. Verse 13. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Next slide. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, you stitched me together, all my personality and characteristics and tendencies and giftedness. God was all part of that. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. Verse 17, how precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. How precious. He knows all of my thoughts in verse 2. And now God has all of these thoughts about him. Verse 18 says, were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I'm still with you. If only you, God, would slay the wicked away from me, you who are bloodthirsty. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Again, this is a diary, okay? Do I not hate those who hate you, Lord, and abhor those who are in rebellion against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them my enemies. He's being honest in his diary. All right, he's just going to say what he's feeling, what's in his heart. Sometimes it helps you to confess to your hatred. Verse 23, search me, O God. Now he's getting to this place where he wants to be. People, God. No, he's not seeing people, God anymore. Trying to put the magnifying glass on all of his faults. No, it's not that kind of God for David. David says, he gets to this place, search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me. and lead me in the way everlasting. You know, David is such a great poet, and he doesn't just give us information about God in this poem, this diary journal entry. He tells us how he feels about that information. He doesn't just give us insights about God. He tells us how his own heart reacts to those insights about God. And like I've been saying, a part of David wants to recoil from triune deity. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. Slide number two, if you would. Verse 6. David is feeling so threatened by the idea of God, a holy God, looking at him all the time, always there, down in the depths of his heart, knowing everything. You hem me in behind and before. Verse 5, he says, you're hemming me in, God. I don't like this experience. And he starts to say in verse 11, if only I could get darkness, if only I could cover up. You know what he's saying? He's saying there's a part of me that doesn't like the fact that you have unfiltered information about me. And I can't stand the idea of you having knowledge about me, looking right into me, and I have no control over that knowledge. I don't like it. There's no room for me in this. And he's really battling that as an experience here in his life. And yet... I think we battle the same things, not just with God, but with each other. And David's coming to this place where he's wanting to experience and encounter God in such a way that he doesn't feel exploited by all that the God knows about him, but instead he feels lifted up. He feels encouraged. And so when we look at a Psalm 139 kind of God, it can be terrifying to us because we've got things in our life that we don't want God necessarily to know about because we're afraid He'll reject us. But if we read it closely, and especially as we look at this psalm in the early verses start giving away to something else besides this feeling of violation, this terror of being known. Because in the beginning, David says, this is too much for me in verse 6. Where can I go to get away? Verse 7. It's more than just a Southwest airline cheap plane ticket. All right? Verse 11 and 12. Maybe the darkness will hide me. Maybe I could cover myself with darkness, but that doesn't work. And we look at verses 8, 9, and 10, and it's very dramatic. And he says, if I go here and get away from you, you're there. If I go here, you're there. If I go here, you're there. And then he says, if I rise on the wings of dawn, if I set on the far side of the sea, even there, he says, is your dehumanizing, untrustworthy peephole gaze. Oh, did he say it that way? Oh, maybe I misspoke. That's not what he says. Even there, your dehumanizing, untrustworthy, exploitive peephole gaze in my life. No. He doesn't say that in his diary, his journal, does he? What does he say? Even there, your hand will guide me. Even there, your right hand will hold me fast. Do you see the change? Do you see it? Can you see how this guy is working through this whole idea of a triune God and what that might mean for him in his life? You see the change? You know, most commentators over the years have seen a change in the tone. If I go over there, you're there. If I go over there, you're there. If I go here, you're there. Your right hand guides me. Your power upholds me. David says here, what if this God, who is so infinite in knowledge and power, what if this God used the infinite knowledge, presence, and power for us to guide us, to uphold us, to care for us? What if he used it all for us? What if he is really good? And that's the question. Yeah, there's a God, but is he good? And other people say, well, there's a God and is he good? And furthermore, what good is he? And Psalmist David answers that question. That this great God is not a God who exploits and is looking to take advantage. He knows, He's present, He's powerful, He's holy, and His justice. David talks about that at the end of the psalm. All of this, instead of being disempowering, it is empowering to know I've got this kind of God above me, beside me, and within me. And so David begins to sense that this is the case. And finally he says, "How precious to me are your thoughts, O God." You know, Derek Kidner, very good Hebrew scholar, very, very well known as a commentary writer on the book of Psalms especially. And he says the word precious is a word where it says, "How precious to me are your thoughts, O God." Verse 17, slide number 4. "How precious are your thoughts to me, O God." He says the word precious is a word that's used to refer to gold, silver, diamonds, rubies, sapphires, emeralds, precious stones. It means ultimate wealth. And in the beginning of the psalm, David was recoiled by this, the thought of this all-powerful, all-knowing God. And he's threatened by God, looking at his thoughts. You know, we see it. "You know what, when I sit down, and you know when I rise, and you perceive my thoughts from afar off, and this is too much for me." And in the beginning, David is thinking about God, looking at his thoughts. But in verse 17, he says, "Your thoughts, O God, your thoughts toward me are like gold and silver and diamonds." And then we get down to verse 23 and 24, and there we have this amazing statement that David says, "Search me, test me, know me. God, I want the deep scan. Now that I know you're good, now that I know there's a lot of good in your life, there's a lot of great things happening in your universe, in your world, I want you to know me top to bottom." And you not only see all the way down to the bottom, but it delights me to have you see me in all the way in. And so in the beginning, like I said, David is scared, like we are. We're so scared. There's no room for me and all of that knowing by God. And I can't breathe. And it's cosmic claustrophobia in front of a Psalm 139 kind of God. Now David's living transparently. And this is what you want, you see. Not to be afraid of the deep scan. Not to be afraid to be known. To drop all your leaves, not to worry so much about what he sees or what anyone else sees. When God looks all the way down into our heart, David has gotten the assurance that God is going to love him. And he knows he's not going to be rejected. And thereby he tells us that this God is good. And he knows that though God is going to find some bad things in there, he's not going to exploit them and he's not going to reject them as a result of it. You see, this is an incredible psalm that tells us about our triune God. You know, the Bible tells us in so many other places, we want to get away from God, and yet we're made for God. We want to be known by God, yet we want to hide from God. We want to be known by others, yet we want to hide from others. And we feel so hemmed in like David, the psalmist. And yet, if we really were able to get away from the presence of God, our life would disintegrate. Our physical world would fall apart. Our psychological world would fall apart. Our spiritual lives would disintegrate. And what's so amazing in the gospel is that Jesus himself, all of that stuff happened to him so that you and I could have a personal relationship with God. You see, Jesus did get cast out of the presence of God. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus was covered with the ultimate darkness. The sun went out as he died. Jesus was stripped naked on a cross. It was more than just a peephole, people looking through the peephole. It was in full view. The whole world could see the shame. And they laughed at him and they jeered at him. He went through the ultimate dehumanization. Why? So you and I could open up our lives to a triune God and not be afraid anymore. So you and I, what's our word? We could believe. You see, when you came to church this morning, what you thought your greatest sin is not your greatest sin. I've said it multiple times, I'll say it again. Your greatest sin this morning is refusing to believe that God can give you a new identity, that you can relate differently to a triune God that maybe you've never related to quite in that way before. That's what you can do. And we're going to give you an opportunity to do that. But you know what? I so appreciate God working in the lives of our people. And this morning, we're going to have Chad Wilson come up and just talk to us a little bit about what it really means to know and follow God, the triune God, in the person of Jesus. I so appreciate this guy. You know, at the chili cook-off, this is what I think of now, Chad, this is what I think of. At the chili cook-off, he was talking to people, and I noticed it was really good chili, and I noticed there was like some chili on the end of his nose.
Did you tell me, though?
I didn't. Yes, I didn't tell you. I thought he will definitely, somebody's gonna tell him. No, he saw several people that day, and then later, I think he posted a picture on Facebook like, guys, help a brother out. So, my apologies. But today, you're here. We love you.
Thanks.
And there's a water for you. I'll be back when you're done. Yeah. Yes, I'll get you one. Yeah. Yeah. Love you, buddy.
Thanks.
Share with us. Yeah.
Hey, first of all, thanks for having me out here. I know that there are like a lot of really intelligent people sitting out there. They could probably come up here and know way more about the Bible and know way more about Jesus and this whole personal relationship. So I'm just pumped that I get to share a little bit with you. And I know that sometimes people think I'm a little weird, and that's true. I am a little strange. And especially about sharing my faith, because I think people look at me and they're like, why do you share your faith so much, in a sense? Like, you're a little bold with that, Chad. Like, a little weird. And I think it's good to know where I came from so that you understand why do I care so much that I get to tell people a little bit about Jesus. And so we, like, rewind and go back to school years, okay? I grew up in an awesome family. They loved me to death, like hugs and kisses and take me everywhere and run me around like a lot of you guys do. Like, I was loved like crazy. But we did not grow up in the church. We didn't go to church on a regular basis. I didn't know Jesus. I didn't know God. Like, I would have said I believe in God, but I didn't know God. And to be real honest with you, I went 18 years of my life, and I don't recall one time where somebody said, Chad, do you know Jesus? Do you know that Jesus died on the cross for you? And so I spent 18 years, and I literally don't think I ever heard those words. And so fast forward, I'm 18 years old, I'm in high school, and I've made a bunch of stupid choices, as many of you high schoolers do. And a buddy just says simple words, hey, Chad, you want to go to church with me? And I was a fairly good kid. Like, if you'd asked me, I'd have said, yeah, I'm going to heaven. Yeah, no problem. I'm a good kid. Like, I don't drink. I don't cuss. A little, but not a lot. So it's not that bad. You know, like, and so I would have thought I'm already good. And so he said, Chad, will you come to church? And he was a pastor's kid. And I went to his little church of 60 people. And those people just poured love into me and showed me who Jesus was. And now I just think, if I get the chance to tell somebody about Jesus, I don't want them to be like, Chad, dude, you knew me for 18 years and you never said anything about Jesus. Like, so I err on the side of like, Jesus, woo! So that's my passion, that's my heart, and so that's why I am the way that I am. So, and the truth is, in a church this size, there's a lot of people. It's a little intimidating. I had a lot of coffee this morning. My feet were fluttering. Joy will tell you I was pretty nervous. But in a church this size, with this many people, I truly believe that there are people here who don't know Jesus. They don't have an intimate relationship with Jesus. And don't get me wrong, if you came to church on daylight savings time Sunday, you woke up an extra early, hour early, right? Like, you believe in God, I'll give you that. But do you know Jesus? Because that's a different question. Do you believe in God? Is different, I think, than do you know or follow Jesus? I think those are two different questions. And a way that I like to illustrate this, and you've probably heard it before, how many of you believe that Michael Jordan played basketball? Not a rhetorical question. Show me hands. If you don't, tech team, you can find a picture of Michael Jordan. Like, it's pretty obvious, right? He played basketball. How many of you believe that Michael Jordan played basketball? Yeah, he played basketball. Duh, Wilson, what are you talking about? That's fine, but if I said, do you know Michael Jordan? Do you have an intimate relationship with Michael Jordan? Like, could you, yo, Jordan, what's up, Bo? You want to go play, shoot some J's? Huh? You want to do that, man, a little later, 3 o'clock after church? Because if you do, come talk to me afterwards. I want to hang out with you, and I can work on my J, okay? So those are different questions. I don't even like the terminology believer and unbeliever. And I know I'm being silly. I get it. It's fine. Believer and unbeliever are fine terms. But I would have said as a high schooler, I believe in God. But I would not have said I'm a follower of Jesus. And so I even want to see like this flipped upside down. I don't want to ask people, do you believe in God? Yeah. Uh-huh. Do you know Jesus? Huh? Like, I want to ask the question, do you follow Jesus? And the reason I feel that way is because even in James 2:19, it says, you believe that there is one God? Good. Even the demons believe and shudder. I just wish that we would ask, do you follow Jesus? Because the Jesus that I know isn't just like some guy who just like, poof, made the world and then like walked away. He wants, as Joey was talking about, to have a personal relationship with you, to care about your every day, right? When you wake up, he wants to be there. When you have that horrible meeting at 9 o'clock, he wants to walk you through that. He wants to be with you. And so I want to go away from believing in God, and I want us to say, do you follow Jesus? And that's what I asked you this morning. Do you follow Jesus? Do you follow him? Not do you believe in him? Because in the Bible, it's saturated. And I'm just going to read a whole bunch of scriptures really fast. And all you have to listen for is follow me. Okay? And my wife doesn't want me to sing this, so I'm not going, follow, 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 follow. Did you guys know that one? She told me not to. I did. So just listen for follow me. Matthew 4:19, come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. Matthew 16:24, then Jesus said to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man sits on the glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Mark 10:21, Jesus looked at him and loved him. This is a rich dude. One thing you lack, he said, go, sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasures in heaven. Then come and follow me. Luke 5:27, after Jesus went out and saw the tax collector by the name of Levi sitting in his tax booth, follow me, Jesus said. Follow me. He didn't say, believe in God. That's not what he said. Follow me. There's another one. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have light of life. And so, I don't ask you this morning if you believe in God. I ask you, do you follow Jesus? Is he a part of your everyday walk? Do you wake up with Jesus? Do you spend time with him throughout the day? Does he impact your decisions? Do you know that you know that you know Jesus? And like, that's a really challenging question even for me. Like, I have to be like, Chad, are you really following Jesus right now? Right? But I think one of the things that it's easy to fall into is that, like, well, I look the part. I'm kind of religious. And Jesus talked to the religious people. They were called Pharisees, right? And they weren't exactly high on Jesus' list of people, right? Well, I go to church, and I know all the scriptures, and I can say all the right things. Sanctify, justify, holy, amen, preach, brother, right? There's nothing wrong with reading your Bible, praying, with going to church on a regular, those are all good things. And I would even say that you're probably going to be closer to Jesus if you do those things. But you can do those things and not know Jesus. You can do those things and just simply be doing them because mommy and daddy made me come, and so it's just what I've always done my entire life. My wife drags me to church, and so I go, and I sleep through the music, and then I kind of listen a little bit. So, I'm not asking if you believe. I'm not asking if you've done all the right checklist things for the last 30 years or 5 years. I don't care if you're 13 or if you're 83. Do you know Jesus? Do you want to follow Jesus? And then if you do, what does that look like? Okay, Chad, well, you just said like going to church and all that stuff's not. What's it look like? I'm going to ask some people to stand up. They had no idea I was doing this. And so this is really embarrassing for them. I have a microphone. Brian Shepherd, if you're in the house, stand up. Rusty Emmert. Ty, I can't say your last name. Alice, I was all over it. Good. Joey Nelson, I know you're here. J.J. Weimer, if you're in the house. My guess is if you look at these people, you already know what I'm talking about. Anybody want to shout it out? They're runners. Thanks, you guys can have a seat. That's really all I need. They're runners. How do you know they're runners? I like this guy. He's funny. Because they run. It bleeds out of everything they do. They run when it's cold. They run when it's dark. They run in the morning. They run at night. They just run. And then, if that wasn't enough, they wear some interesting clothing when they run, right? Like short shorts. And I'm just calling it like it is. Hey, guys, I've been converted. I wear the short shorts now. So I'm with you, all right, brothers? Okay, I'm following. Now, you can tell that they're runners. It bleeds through everything they do. And the question is, not are you a runner, are you a follower of Jesus? Does it bleed out of everything that you do? Would people look at you and go, oh, there's that crazy runner guy. There's that crazy runner for Jesus. Do they do that with your life? Do people at work go, that guy wakes up at like 5 o'clock to read his Bible and like he always is quoting scripture and like he's on fire for Jesus. And so this morning, I believe that there are some steps to following Jesus. I think the first and foremost, the biggest one, hands down, I'm probably over my time, I'm sorry. Romans 10:9. And I think this is like, if you haven't done this, even if you're doing all the right check marks, you're not there. Romans 10:9. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord and that he was raised from the dead, then you will be saved. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. And I think that first part's actually a pretty big part too. Like, have you ever told anybody that, yeah, I am a sinner and I needed Jesus' grace? Have you done that? Because there's confess with your mouth. He wants every part of your life. He's that big of a God. Other things. In James 2:14, it talks about having faith and deeds and how they go hand in hand. And if Jesus is this personal God that Joey talked about, if he wants to be a part of your everyday life, my guess is it's going to spill out in the way that you run your life, right? We're not all going to be at the same spot, right? I'm a runner, but I'm not Brian Shepherd. We're not in the same spot. But you will see me running. I do wear those shorts sometimes. I go out sometimes when it's cold, right? And we're not all in the same spot in our spiritual journey. But people should look at you and be like, yeah, they follow Jesus. So, how does that overflow? It overflows into your relationships. How do you treat your wife? How do you treat your kids? How do you love them, right? How do you treat the people that you work with? Do you encourage them? Do you pray for them? Do you offer those things up? Do you love all people regardless of their sin issues? I'm going to say that one again. Do you love all people regardless of their issues? And one of my favorite verses, Isaiah 6:8. Do you say every day to God, to Jesus, here I am, Lord, send me. Today is the day that the Lord gave me. Here I am, God, send me. Send me to be an impact on the world. And if you have a personal relationship with Jesus, if you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, he wants every part of your life. And when I was 18 years old, a kid loved me enough to tell me that. And so, I believe that if you get all these things, and you totally get it, that it's impossible for you not to share your faith with other people. It's impossible for you not to say, man, in Mark 16:15, he said to them, go into the world and preach the gospel, the good news to everybody. And so, like, I want you guys to understand that God is real. He wants you just the way that you are. He wants to work in your life. He's not the peephole God that Joey was talking about. He's the let's deal with everything that you've got going on. I'm going to help you walk through it. I'm going to be there with you. I'm going to love you through it. And my prayer is that somebody in here heard that, and somebody that's been waiting to make that choice to say yes to Jesus, to follow him. I pray that this morning you would get it, that you wouldn't be about believing in God, which is okay, but you'd be about following Jesus, which is way, 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 way better. All right, that's all I got, Joey. You're up, buddy.
Give him a hand.
That was awesome. I loved it. Great job. I loved it. Yep. I've been hoping to do more just team teaching here at Sands Hill. So praise God. And Chad did a great job. And so appreciate that. And just thanks to you and for being here this morning. And we want to give you an opportunity just to respond personally to the message that's been presented to you this morning. I know that may put some of you out of your comfort zone, but we want to give you that opportunity before we get out of here. And here's how I like to set it up. Sometimes I try to think of ways of how the Lord might have us to conclude our experience and our time together. And this comes up to me from someone who's heard the sermon and heard Chad speak, and he just texted me here on my phone. He's here this morning. For those who think they are not worthy to come and know and have a relationship with God, the David who wrote these Psalms also committed adultery, conspiracy to, and resulted in the murder of that same woman's husband. This same David was not a waste, was not unwanted, was not thrown away by God, because he repented and he came back to a close relationship with God. David was a king, shepherd, unfavored son of his own dad, but also a normal human being who also did bad things. You a David this morning? We have some Davids in our midst. Maybe those are the same issues in your life. Maybe you've got some other things in your life that you'd rather the all-seeing hand and eye of God not know about. We're going to play a song for you, give you an opportunity to personally respond. You guys just go ahead and play this song for us. Some of you guys are going to recognize this.
Within the sorrow.
Thank you, God, for giving us this morning, and thank you so much for just setting up a moment for us. And we've needed this moment. And we thank you for your love and your kind, gentle whisper and your witness to us this morning. Our prayer is that we would totally trust you. And we invite you to take the deep scan from top to bottom, to look into an interior part of our life. Bring us face to face with what you find. And may we throw ourselves onto the grace and kindness of the Lord Jesus Christ extended to all of us. Thank you for being a personal God, being with us in our laughter, with us in our tears, with us in the fight and the battle, with us as we figure out issues related to discipleship and what it means to follow you, with us, beside us, above us, within us. Thank you, God. We trust you. In your name, amen. Brogan, have you used any chapstick today? Those lips look pretty clear to me, so I think you're good. You can walk out of here and hold your head high. Let's stand, shall we? Thank you, guys. You have a great day.